also our March of Dimes meal afterwards. And so I hope all of you stay for that. And thanks again to Whitney for rolling some beautiful announcements, and hope you're watching them and looking at them. And I won't go over them, but what I want to emphasize a little bit is a reminder, each Easter, we ask everyone to maybe pitch in a little extra money in the offering plate that day, because that's our local mission offering. And any amount that we collect on Easter Sunday, over 2,000 goes to some local projects. Last year, we made a big donation with Shop with the Cobb in Greenville, and then also Noah Church and School and Appalachian Helping Hands. So we'll be receiving that offering next week. Warren's got some new neighbors. Warren, do you want to introduce them to everyone?
We, just back a month ago or so, I guess we discovered that we were going to have some good neighbors. And from the West Coast, this is Les. Stand up.
Microphone. Here we go.
You're Marci. You're wearing my front.
Exciting and new that's taking place. It's going to be offered up at the center, and we want to get everybody involved in it. So,
well, this is something that God's been putting on my heart for a long time, and Marci called. This is something that I've been doing with the kids here at the church for probably 3 or 4 years now, I guess, but. This is kind of opening it up to the community, doing art with God and with me, and just hanging out up in the art room, just creating cool things with God, painting, and just, we'll just be using different kinds of medium. This week we're going to be doing like the crucifix, kind of paintings in frames, and we're going to be maybe making some really cool pretty Easter eggs too. And about maybe once a month, I might do an adult workshop. I've got a lot of people that are interested in that. So I've got a lot of people putting a bug in my ear about that. But it's going to start if you want to bring your kids, if they can do it, just, I'm only going to do one project a week. So if you bring your kids once a week, they'll get the project for the week. I've had several people ask me, well, what about maybe two times a week? So if we get enough interest, I might do a second project in a week. But for now, we're going to start with one project a week. My first session is going to be on Mondays right after school, just whenever you can get here. Probably it'll be starting like around 3:30 or so, a little early, a little late, doesn't matter. On Tuesdays, because I know we have a lot of people that work, the session will be around 5:30, like again, a little early, a little late. Emily's going to be helping me on Monday, so if you have like preschoolers, kindergartners, young kids, you know Emily is really great with those guys. On Tuesdays, Katie Powers is going to be helping me, and that's when we're going to do the 5:30, somewhere around and through there, whenever you can get here. On Wednesdays is after school, and I know, you know, that's going to be when some of the kids here are going to be interested, because that you can come and be here and then go into communicants, that kind of thing. So Wednesday's probably the session that's going to cover a lot of the kids that go here. Thursday, we're leaving Thursday open for now. But if I, you know, get a really big response to this, then we may have a Thursday session. Wednesday is when Olivia Graham's going to be helping me. And on Friday, I've got my Cali girl, because Friday's the only day that she's ever open. And we're hoping that Friday's a big day when kids don't have a lot of after-school practices, that kind of thing. The kids that are involved in sports, Friday's their only day. So we're going to do an after-school on Friday, and we're also going to do one that starts around 5:30. So we're hoping to do two sessions on Friday. So I'm hoping with that's about five different sessions. We're hoping that everybody can find at least one time during that time that you can have your kid here. And I'm hoping to keep all sessions $10 and under. You know, it's basically just covering the art supplies. And I'm hoping my teens are going to make a little money from this too, because these are teens that that are always participating in stuff here at church, but they don't get paid. So hopefully this is something that's going to make a little money for them too. And I am so excited about this. And this is just a new journey with God that He's just been putting on my heart for a long time. And I know how special it's been for me, and hopefully it's been special for the kids of this church too. But just opening it up for the kids of this community and this county to come and experience something different that they've never experienced and been a part of before. Just being able to co-create with God, it's a special thing. And these kids really connect spirit to spirit with God through this. So if you have friends out in the community, children that love to be creative, that love to paint and don't get a lot of, you know, time to do things like that, I'd love for you to put a bug in people's ear, and I'm going to post it again on Facebook and hopefully make some flyers this week, and this is going to be a good thing. I feel like this is going to be another ministry for our church. I really feel that God's put that on my heart, that this is going to be a ministry for our church, just like the mission work and the reaching out with the Spirit-filled fellowship and the other things we do. This is going to be an actual ministry. So keep it in prayer. And I thank all of you. Put the word out there.
Are you going to do it this Friday?
Yeah.
Don't forget, next week is Easter Cantata, doing our morning worship. And invite some friends that maybe not involved in church, or if they go to an early service, have them come out and join us at Cantata. Also, hope you took note, the Easter Sunrise service this year will not be at our house. It's going to be at the center. Our house is in turmoil because of renovations. So that's a nice word, turmoil.
Yeah. Flux, a state of flux.
It's a what?
A state of flux.
Oh, it's a state of flux. Okay, well, that's an understatement. Okay. We're glad to hear, and we'll now start with a word of prayer as we begin our worship service. Father, we thank you for this day. On this Palm Sunday, as we remember the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. We thank you, Lord God, for your presence in our lives. We thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit in our worship service this morning. We want to, in all that we do, through music, through the word that's read, through the word that's preached, to offer and to see every part of our worship today will bring you honor and your glory, and to you glory. And pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Welcome to our worship today. Pastor Harrell probably didn't realize that Gael was here for the first time. Welcome, Gael. We're so glad that you came. And some of you may not have noticed, but after last week, after that tremendous faux pas that I made, that Sharon Clark has returned. So,
what she told me was she came back to see what if you were going to do this week.
Comedy show.
We don't want to disappoint you here. Everyone else here, welcome. We know that we're the family of God here. We know that we're not here by accident, but that God has called us by name, that he knows us personally, to come here and be part of this family that worships him at Cedar Creek. The canopy of heaven is open. So whatever it is that you need, whatever, be it healing, be it financial, be it emotional, be it just anything, he's here for you. The Lord Jesus Christ. All the promises of God in him are yea and amen. That means if you find it in the Bible, it's yours. It's yours. And God is here for you today. And we join our hearts in worship today in a very exciting way with our children. And we'll start the choir. I'll just kind of walk you through it. The choir will start. And then we invite you to sing with us. You can sing with us the whole time. Then the kids will come through. And then after that, we'll stand for our first hymn, which is Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. And the number, if you want to look it in the hymn book, is number 248. Okay. Let's stand as we welcome the presence of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ.
Grace from your
the most? The one who thought you were worth dying for? The one who is glorious and risen? Who welcomes you into his arms? Let's worship him, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
we had some, of course, Ella, probably the poster child as she was for March of Dimes. But we had other preemies born in the church. Allie was how many weeks with me?
6 months.
Okay. And I believe TJ.
TJ.
Was early. Anybody else had premature babies? Okay, come on up, Lisa. You got Ella with you.
Yeah, I did.
You had one? Okay.
Yeah. He's grown up.
This is my little partner in crime. She's the reason that I still do my job. One of the reasons I love helping these little babies. I'm Lisa. I cover all 13 counties of Upper East Tennessee for the March of Dimes, and of course I met Gwen and her family, and they've become like family to me. But we help moms that are pregnant, we help babies that are born prematurely, babies that are born with a birth defect, and infant mortality. 1 in 10 babies in Tennessee is born prematurely. That doesn't sound like a lot, but in the United States, that's 500,000 babies are born prematurely. Every 4.5 minutes in the United States, a baby is born with a birth defect. So you can see how urgent our mission is to raise money to help babies like Ella. And this will be my 10th year with the March of Dimes, and I've actually seen a lot of advances. I keep seeing babies being born earlier and earlier. I know you can't even imagine seeing them in the NICU, but when a baby's born 23, 24 weeks, a normal pregnancy is 40 weeks, those babies, some of them weigh just a pound. No bigger than a candy bar, if you can imagine. They're so small, and they have so many problems. And so that's what we do. We do the work. Right now, we're in our biggest campaign. I'll give you a brief history lesson, because I know y'all don't want me to talk all day, but I could talk all day about the March of Dimes. We have been around for 79 years. I know many of you are older people in the church fundraised for us in schools. Franklin D. Roosevelt, one of our presidents, he was the founder of the March of Dimes, and he founded the March of Dimes during his 6th year of presidency. He contracted polio, and polio was almost like it was a debilitating disease. It killed lots of people. And so he had this vision, if everybody in 1938, imagine 1938, if everybody sent dimes to the White House, dimes were affordable in 1938, he had this vision that they would find a cure for polio. Well, it took them about 13 years, but they found the cure for polio, and they changed the mission to be about babies and helping babies. And so that's what we do. And today we have your church, and Gwen has been gracious enough to do a fundraiser for us to raise money for the March of Dimes. Greene County, our walk is coming up April 30th at Laughlin Hospital. We would like to raise $48,000. I don't know if any of you were out in Greenville yesterday, but they had roadblocks all over for the March of Dimes yesterday. We raised about $6,000 yesterday, so we welcome you afterwards. I know we have a great silent auction to win. I don't know what some of the items are, but we welcome you to come afterwards and share with us, and we'd be happy to answer any questions for you.
Thank you, Lisa.
Not been down to Warm Springs, Georgia. It's where FDR came down because of the springs there, and they built through the efforts, I guess March of Dimes must have participated in it. Big facility there where polio patients came, and the therapeutic waters there, the Warm Springs of Georgia, helped a lot of folks. So thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Bob. Good work that March of Dimes is doing for our children. This time we will continue our worship with our sermon hymn. It's number 24, if you use the hymn book, or the deep, deep love of Jesus, and we'll dismiss our children with the last verse of children's. Thank you.
replied, "The Lord needs him." So they brought the colt to Jesus and threw some of their clothing across its back for Jesus to sit on. Then the crowd spread out the robes along the road ahead of him. And as they reached the place where the road started down from the Mount of Olives, the whole procession began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles Jesus had done. "God has given us a king," they exulted. "Long live the king. Let all heaven rejoice. Glory to God in the highest heavens." But some of the Pharisees among the crowd said, "Sir, rebuke your followers for saying things like that." He replied, "If they keep quiet, the stones along the road will burst into cheers." And I encourage you all to read that next, the rest of the chapter. You guys are not that scary. It's just that I just have a really severe reaction to my own adrenaline. And when I get a little of it, it just whoop. But read the rest of that chapter. The next verse will break your heart, and you know the rest of the story.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jean. Whitney, if you'll pull the response and read it back up. Isaiah chapter 43. And we do that as a key verse in the responsive reading I want us to focus on. Begin with the verse 14, and we're going to read through verse 21. But it's verse 19 I want us to key on, which is the word of God, the Lord came through Isaiah and said, "See, I'm doing a new thing." And what happened on Palm Sunday was a new thing. And that's going to be the topic by sermon this morning. So I invite you to join me there in the responsive reading from Isaiah 43. I'll start with the first verse, verse 14. We'll alternate reading, and then we'll all read together verse 21. This is what the Lord says, "Your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your sake I will send you to Babylon and bring down as fugitives all the Babylonians in the ships in which they took pride.
I am the Lord, your Holy One, Israel's Creator, your King."
This is what the Lord says, "He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters,
who drew out the chariots and horses, the army and reinforcements together, and they lay there, never to rise again, extinguished, snuffed out like a wick.
Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past.
See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland.
The wild animals honor me, the jackals and the owls, because I provide water in the desert and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen.
The people I formed for myself, that they may proclaim my praise.
May the Lord bless to us once again the reading and hearing of his holy word. I hesitated in this sermon to use a cartoon as an illustration. And the reason is, you have to look at a cartoon to really get the picture. So I will try to set the stage for this cartoon so you get what the message is from it. Everybody knows Kermit the Frog, right? No? Okay. Kermit is a what? Well, he's a frog, but what? He's not a real frog, is he? He's a puppet. All right. And inside a puppet, what do you find?
A hand.
A hand. Okay. So this was a cartoon. Kermit the Frog is sitting in the doctor's office. And the doctor in the cartoon is holding up an x-ray of Kermit that shows the hand inside of Kermit. And then the doctor says, what I'm about to tell you is going to change your life forever. Okay. You get the picture? Kermit thinks he's a real frog, right? But the doctor's about to announce to him, you're not a real frog. You got a hand inside of you. The point of the cartoon is about change. And the doctor concludes the last sentence. He says, are you really sure you want to know it? You know, and sometimes we deal with change. There's some things, sometimes we're reluctant to want to know because it will change our lives. The Gospel of Luke and his writings, of course, that we know as the Acts of the Apostles, is a series of stories that are life-changing. If you're not sure about that, and you can't really zoom in or focus in on what those life-changing stories are, go back, and this is a good time during the Easter season, to read Luke's Gospel. And then to follow through, skipping John's Gospel, to go to the book of Acts and read, because it is a series of life-changing events. And just as a matter of review, or you forgot what some of those are, and we have had sermons on them over the last few months, beginning around Christmas time. The life-changing event began in Luke's Gospel with Zechariah and Elizabeth, a couple who wanted a child desperately. But Elizabeth was unable to conceive, and they were well beyond childbearing age. But it was with the birth of that child, John the Baptist, that their lives were changed forever because of a miracle from God. When the angel announced to Mary that she would conceive by the power of the Holy Spirit and bear the Christ child, her life and the life of Joseph were changed forever. In Luke 2, the second chapter of Luke, when Jesus was 12 years old, he went to the temple and he debated the religious leaders. And they were amazed at his knowledge. And when Mary and Joseph found him, Jesus said to him, didn't you know that I must be in my Father's house and about my Father's business? At that point, Jesus' life was changed forever. When Jesus returned from the desert after being tempted by Satan, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath. That was his custom. And he read from the prophet Isaiah that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me. And Jesus' life was changed forever from that point as he began his ministry. From the time that Jesus preached the good news and healed the sick, all those whose lives were touched by his presence and his ministry, their lives were changed forever. The sick were healed, and they have a future. The blind's eyes were open, and they could see for the first time, and their lives were changed forever. The same for the lame, the leper, the possessed, forever changed by the power of the anointing of Jesus as he touched their lives. And then the day arrived in Luke chapter 9 when Jesus told his disciples, "The time has come for you to change from being ordinary fishermen and tax collectors, to change from your ordinary occupation to be disciples with power and authority to do what I have been doing." And Luke's account says that Jesus gave them power and authority to cast out demons and to heal the sick. And their lives were changed forever. In Luke chapter 10, Jesus sent out 72 messengers, and he told them, "Go and heal the sick and tell them the kingdom of God is near you." And when they returned from their mission and reported to Jesus that even the demons obey us when we use your name, Luke said that Jesus was filled with the joy of the Holy Spirit. And he said, "O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, thank you for hiding these things from those who think themselves wise and clever, and for revealing them to the childlike." And here's the amazing paradox of that whole life-changing event with the 72 messengers. The wise became foolish, and the foolish became wise. It's a life-changing experience for both groups of people. The good news was, and still is, that when we come to Jesus, we come not through the power and position, ability and wisdom of our lives, but we come to Jesus through a childlike faith. And that's the message, not only throughout scriptures, but particularly on Palm Sunday, as Jesus came into Jerusalem. The children went before him, as our children this morning came, waving palms and shouting and singing and rejoicing. And the kingdom of God is for those who come to Jesus with that childlike faith. Not those who come and say, "I claim the kingdom because I'm a powerful person, I'm a wealthy person, or I have a position, I have ability, I'm all wise." Jesus said, "No, the kingdom is hidden from those who claim that they are the wisest, but it is revealed to those who claim to be the simple, the childlike." When Jesus entered Jerusalem on what we celebrate today is Palm Sunday, his entry would set up a final confrontation between the religious leaders whose spiritual pride rejected the good news. And it would set up an opportunity for those who walked with Jesus on that road into Jerusalem with childlike faith, whose lives would be changed forever by the touch of Jesus. Luke's account says that as Jesus rode in the city on a donkey, the crowd shouted, "Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heavens." And as Jean read this morning, the religious leaders rebuked him and commanded that Jesus tell his followers to be quiet. Quiet it down. Be a little more reverent. Reverence for the King has to do with silence and stillness. We don't want to have any outbursts of emotions or feelings. But Jesus said that if they kept quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. The response of Jesus in verse 42 illustrates the consequence of rejecting the power of God in the person of Jesus to bring about change in one's lives. Jesus said, "How I wish today that you of all people would understand the way to peace. But now it's too late," Jesus said, "and peace will be hidden from your eyes." That's a terrible announcement, isn't it? But they brought it upon themselves. In their wisdom, they could not imagine what the kingdom of God was about in terms of approaching it with a childlike faith and an openness to rejoicing and celebrating and praising. But Jesus said, it's too late. You've heard me now for 3 years, and you still reject me. We all know the old saying, it's never too late to change. But that quote has a limit to it. And Jesus is saying, time does run out. You reach the point of rejection that there are no other chances. And the rejection of Jesus as Lord and Savior, the Bible teaches, is a final one. Once we reject Jesus, the final opportunity for change is lost. And that's what Jesus is teaching the Pharisees and the scribes who claim to have that inner track to the kingdom of God. And Jesus said, you're wrong. That track is not through your wisdom and knowledge. It is through the person of Jesus Christ. And it is through childlike faith that you come into the kingdom. And the response of those who make that step into the kingdom is the response of those on the road to Jerusalem that day, who shouted and cried out and rejoiced and celebrated. You know, change rubs against our human nature, doesn't it? How many of you like change? And some of you, I mean, somehow like Stephanie, she likes change. Every day changes for her. She got something going on different every day. But most of us don't like change. Most of us are comfortable with the way things are. And anytime something is changed, it upsets our thinking and our action and the way we respond. And that applies to every aspect of our lives, and it even applies to our work. I don't often tell stories about previous churches, but this one just so illustrates why I want us to understand today. In our last church, there was an elderly woman who was a matriarch of the church. And when she found herself near the end of her life, one of the things she said to her family was, don't let them change my church. Don't let them change my church. There was change beginning to take place. But she was comfortable with the way it had been before. And the key word there is, don't let them change my church. Whose church is it? It's not ours. But change is difficult. And the thing we need to understand from the scripture is we're not the change agents of either our lives or the change agent of our church. Who is? Jesus, God, the Holy Spirit. The Bible teaches that when we humbly submit ourselves to the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives and in the worship of our church, change happens because God is always doing a new thing. You remember the verse from Isaiah 43? Where the Lord said, but forget all that. It's nothing compared to what I'm going to do. For I'm about to do something new. See, it's already begun. Do you not see it? But here's where we have to be cautious and careful. Because we live in a world today where there's a world of changing values and standards. And the world is constantly wanting us to change, particularly as Christians, to change our position and our beliefs to conform to what the world thinks. We only need to take a look at contemporary society to see that. Change from God always aligns and conforms to the Word of God. The Word never changes. The world changes, but the Word doesn't. That may seem kind of contradictory. Well, God is doing a new thing. We need to be prepared to change. But we have to be careful that the change that happens in our lives as Christians is change initiated by God, and it always conforms to His Word. I'll give you one example. The world's view about marriage has changed, hasn't it? It's changed rapidly. But marriage is still defined not by the world, but is still defined by the Word. The kingdom of God comes to release us from the world, not to get us to conform to the world. And the new thing that God is doing is, in one sense, not really new, but it's releasing, once again, the power and authority of the kingdom of God into the church, that we might be renewed within the Word of God. Warren is a real historian. He knows history. He knows historical trends and changes. If you look at the history from the time of Jesus to today, the church has often gone through a renewal process. The Reformation was an example of where the church had conformed to the world. And the Reformation happened. Luther and Calvin and Zwingli all came preaching, let's get back to the Word. What does the Word say about our salvation? And then the church slides again into conforming to the pattern of the world. And the Great Awakening happened in our country in the 1800s. Revivals broke out all along the frontier, particularly, and thousands of people came to camp meetings that lasted for days and weeks. And then the church fell back into conforming the pattern of the world. And then in the turn of the 20th century, a great revival in terms of once again, understanding the power of the Holy Spirit came into the church. And then the church slipped back into conformity to the world. And in the 50s and 60s, with the charismatic renewal, there was a tremendous outpouring of the Spirit. The church, once again, conformed to the Word instead of the world. And then it slipped back. And that's the pattern. And what God is doing when He said in Isaiah 43, see, I'm doing a new thing, what He's doing is calling the church back to the Word. And in every generation, that's really something new, because even the church has forgotten what the Word said about the power of God to change people's lives. So the new is not really new, but it's a new thing to each generation where the power of God is released and people's lives are changed. The first step to seeing the change that God wants to do in our lives and our worship is to change our hearts. It begins here. Change my heart, O God. May I be like You. And what the Bible teaches clearly is when we take that step in a childlike faith of letting Jesus change our hearts, then we are renewed. Then the newness of what God's Word is for us to do in the world is released to us in a new way. Do you not see it? It's already happening around us. It's happening in this church. It's happening in every church. It's happening in every part of the world. And we see it. When we celebrate as those children and adults did on that road into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday. It's already begun. But we're going to be a part of it. And the first step is to change our hearts. That's going to be our hymn. It's a very beautiful little hymn. It's not in a red hymn book, but it's in the celebration. Change my heart, O God. And that's the first step to experiencing the new thing that God wants to do in our lives. Let's pray. Father, if we bow before you today, on this Palm Sunday, when we remember that your son Jesus came into Jerusalem, and he was going to be rejected by the religious, going to be rejected by the authorities. He's going to be tried, crucified. But Father, thank you for the new thing that we know happened on Easter. When he was raised to life so that we might be raised to life just as Jesus was. Help us to see that new thing you're doing today. That new thing you're doing in each of our lives. That new thing you're doing in the life of your church. And a new thing you're doing in the world today. And we see it through the eyes of a childlike faith. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. And we'll stand for our heavenly commitment, which is to change my heart with God. And as we sing, let it be a prayer. Let it be a prayer between you and God that your heart is changed so that God can do that new thing.
Thank you. Gary Fillers, Wendy Ashley, Nellie Dodd, Chad Goins, the families of Hugh LaRue, Haley Wilcox, and Harvey Freshour. Are there any more prayer requests? Any praises? Do you have a prayer request back there, Jackson? We will put Phil Shipley on there. Uh-oh. How is Phil?
He's doing a lot better yesterday.
Good. Good.
He took a true picture of how he wanted Jackson to throw the ball to it and he could write next. So he's good.
Good. Can he move his left side?
They said he moved his left a little bit.
We'll keep speaking to him. Any prayer requests up here? Okay, first Warren.
I would just ask a prayer for our brothers and sisters in Christ in Egypt after
yes.
the assault this morning on my faith.
Yes, I know. Okay. And Emily? Kenny Handy, soon to deploy. Okay.
They're scared.
Okay, Wendy. Anybody else? Okay. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you this day that you are our place of refuge. That when our world is falling apart, that you are the one thing that never changes. Thank you, Lord, that as you call us your children, that you are interested and care about everything that concerns us. Thank you, Lord, that we have this church family here, a family that loves you and loves each other. Thank you, Lord, that you are always ready to help us. No matter what the problem is, that you are there. And Lord, we have some dear people that we want to bring before you. Not that you don't already know, but just so that we can join our faith to you. We pray, Heavenly Father, for Kenny Hamby as he prepares himself to deploy to Helmand Province. We pray the protection of Psalm 91 over him and the protection of Isaiah 54:17, that no weapon formed against him will prosper. We pray that 1,000 may fall at his side and 10,000 at his right hand, that he will not be touched. We believe you for it, Lord. We believe your word. Heavenly Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters that are caught up in religious conflict, especially those of the Coptic Christian faith in Egypt today. We pray for your hand of protection to be over them. Your hand of deliverance to be over them. Father, when we speak of our Coptic brothers and sisters, our minds filled with the images of those brave men in the orange jumpsuits whose last words were, "Jesus, Jesus." And we know that you honor them. Heavenly Father, we pray now for people in our congregation that are battling sickness or battling disease. And we thank you, Lord, that Jesus has redeemed us from sickness, that Jesus is the healer, that by his stripes we are healed. We thank you, Lord, that there is nothing too difficult for you. And you say to us, only believe, only believe. And so now we put our faith and our trust in you to heal these people. Gary Fillers, totally healed. Wendy Ashley, totally healed. Ashley Landers, totally and completely healthy. Eddie Fillers, every organ in his body operating normally. Every system in his body operating normally. And he may stand in the midst of this congregation and give praise to you. Father, we pray again for Phil Shipley. And we keep our prayers, as you say, keep them coming. We keep them coming for Phil Shipley, and we speak to his body. In the name of Jesus Christ, Phil Shipley, be healed. I command your body to lose paralysis. Paralysis, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to leave Phil's body now. I speak to every organ in Phil's body, and I say, be healed in the name of Jesus. Every system in his body, be healed in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the new thing that you are doing in this church. And the new thing that you are doing, constantly doing in our world. And I thank you that the new thing expands to the universe. I thank you for it. You are a glorious God. I pray that you forgive us for wanting to linger in your presence. I pray, Heavenly Father, that we may stay here in this place of refuge, knowing that here we are being held together by our church family and being held together by you, by the word of your power. And Lord, as we cling to you in this time, we pray for the families that have had to say goodbye this week. For the family of Hugh LaRue, for all of them, for the Collins family. For Eddie and Sam and Becky Wilcox and Tanya and Anthony and Olivia. Comfort them, we pray, as they have said goodbye for a while to Helen. And Heavenly Father, I pray for Harvey's precious family. The family that just keeps on expanding. The family of this great man. Heavenly Father, we just want to hold on to you a little bit longer. Just want to thank you that everything starts with you. Our entire being starts with you. And we end with you. And we want to thank you that you hold us all in your hands. and no one can snatch us out of your hands. And no situation. We pray for those that have a heavy heart today, that you will lift them up and give them hope. We pray for those who have lost their way, that you will show them the way, and they will follow as the fishermen did. We thank you. Jesus, we can't thank you enough on this Palm Sunday for coming to earth, for being our Savior, for being our brother. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit so that we're never alone, that we're always in your presence. We thank you, Jesus. We love you. And we join our hearts together today as we pray the prayer you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This time, let's receive our morning tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
bunch of items, silent auction items are then there. Look at those and make a bid. I think they'll close that out at some point during the meal. And just a reminder, Holy Week services, just about everything's going to be up at the center on the hill. Thursday night, Maundy, Holy Thursday service, and then the sunrise service as well. And the Easter egg hunt on Saturday for the kids and adults who are going to come. Jackson, you going to do the closing prayer? No. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I'll do it. Just by Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this service we've had. Thank you for each person who's here today. And Father, as we leave today, help us always to be aware of something new you want to do in our lives and some change you want to make in our lives for our betterment. And we thank you for your word today. And may the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit dwell in our lives both this day and forever.